bless the Lord. It's time to go to worship. Are you glad to be here today? Yeah? Father, we bless you today, and we ask you that your presence be here in a great way. We surrender all that we are and all that we have to you today. And God, we ask for your presence to be so known in this place today that when we leave, we can say that it was not just good to go to church, but something in us has become less like us and more like you. And we give you praise and glory for that today in Jesus' name. Can you say amen?
Through you the blind will see. Through you the mute will sing. Through you the dead will rise. Through you all hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees. Through you my heart screams, I am free. I'm
gonna sing that again. Here we go.
Through you the blind will see. Through you the mute will sing, yeah. Through you the dead will rise. Through you all hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees. Through you my heart screams, I am free. Yes, I am free. I am free.
I am free to live.
want to go to God's Word today before you get impatient and before noontime rolls around and we start thinking about other things. Let's think about God right now. Amen. For the next 25, oh, be realistic, Pastor. 35, Pastor, be realistic. I can't believe the reputation I have. I mean, even yesterday, where's Rick Hochstetler? He's had all these puppies. He's probably home. He's home with the puppies, but Donna's here. Your brother-in-law picked on me yesterday, Donna, in front of everybody at the Wild Game Feed yesterday. Somehow word is getting out of how short my messages are, and so he tried to use one of my little things. He said, how many will give me, what, one or two more minutes? One, two, three. That's what he did. I can't believe he did that. Anyway, shame on Rick. If Rick is home watching this, shame on you, Rick. Go with me to Genesis this morning. I am tickled about this sermon. Now, I'm going to tell you something. Those who are watching us via live stream, maybe so much, maybe a little bit more, because you know you're probably in a comfortable position. You know, you've got your morning drink or your toast or your donut sitting back watching us this morning. You might be at risk a little bit more. But I want to let you know this morning, I have some history. And I know when it comes to biblical history, it's warm in here, or maybe I'm the only one that's warm, but it seems a little warm in here today. I don't know if we've switched over from heat to our AC yet, but please, if you see somebody beside you, you know, do one of these, give them a little nudge. You have permission this morning. Don't slap them. Don't hit them too hard, but give them a little nudge. I want to prepare you that all week long, Donna's ready. She's got the slapper out, right? Everyone's slapping Donna. I love you, Donna. We're going to look at some biblical history this morning, but I promise you, if you will help me pull this cart up the hill, we will enjoy the ride down together. But we've got to get through the biblical history this morning, and then I'm going to share some personal things with you that God has been speaking to my heart about me and about our church family that I think you are really going to enjoy. Genesis chapter 13, we're going to read the first four verses. We have all the scriptures on PowerPoint, so you can find them there this morning as we go along in this message. The Bible says, beginning in that first verse of Genesis chapter 13, that Abram went from Negev with his wife and everything he had, and Lot went with him. Verse 2, Abraham had become very wealthy in livestock and in silver and gold. And from the Negev, he went from place to place and came to Bethel. Now, there's a comma there. And notice this. To the place between Bethel and Ai, where his tent had been earlier, and where he had first built an altar. There, Abram called on the name of the Lord. Would you just bow your head maybe right where you are? You know, we haven't done this for a while, and I had somebody ask me about this a couple of weeks ago, and would you pray this prayer with me? Would you put your hand or maybe your Bible or your electronic device right on your heart today that you read your word from? And can we make this vow and pledge to the Lord today? Would you just say right out to the Lord today, would you say, Lord, here I am. Speak to my heart and change my mind. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let me give you some historical significance with this verse of Scripture. There's a lot of things surrounding this portion of Scripture that I have had the blessing, the privilege of researching and reading over the last couple of weeks, and it's been stirring excitement in my heart. Many of us would recall, maybe in our younger days, Father Abraham had many sons. Rob, why don't you stand right up? Come on. No, sit down. That's okay. I was just joking. Many sons had Father Abraham. I am one of them, and so were you. So let's just... Oh, you sing like white folk. You sing like white folk. Abraham has the title, the father of the faithful. Abraham did not get this name by accident. And nor did he get this name by the allocation of man. Abraham got the name Father of the Faithful because he was a God chaser. Now, Mama always told me never to point a finger at anybody, but I'm going to give you permission this morning to turn to somebody. Dave, I don't see Lori sitting by you, so you might have to point in front of you at Danny, but somebody, point at somebody and ask them, look them right in the eye, are you a God chaser? I know this is a little uncomfortable, isn't it, if you're new here or visiting this morning. I know. Are you a God chaser? Just point that finger right at them. Are you a God chaser? Abraham was a God chaser. And his journey of chasing God also caused him to be an incredible worshiper and an altar builder. The title of my message this morning is Revitalizing a Place Called the Altar. Now, there are many times that we see individuals in the Bible building altars, and I want to look at Abraham today, and I've got two things I want to do. And then I'm going to share with you something personal that the Lord has been speaking to me and I believe wants to speak to us today. The first thing that I want to do is I want to talk really quickly about the three altars of Abraham. Can we do that? Remember in our text, and I think I have this as the next point, the PowerPoint, Shar. It's good to have Lyle and Shar back home. Hey! Dan and Rose. Woohoo! Hope I don't miss anybody. It's good to have Danny Woods here today. I don't know. You look like you were being left out, Danny, so I just want to. Three altars of Abraham. Are you ready? I want you to write these down. The first altar of Abraham comes from that portion of Scripture kind of tucked away in the verses that we opened up with where it says, the place between Bethel and Ai, where his tent had been earlier and where he had first built an altar. I'm going to give you the Scripture reference to this in just a moment, but here's altar number one. Jot this down. There's three cities, three altars, and the names of the cities are very significant. I'll say that again. The historical names of the cities are very significant to the places where Abraham built his altars. And this first one is the altar, or is the city, by the name of Shechem. S-H-E-C-H-E-M. It's actually spelled different in the Hebrew, but I won't give you that. In the English, it's Shechem, which means shoulder. So for all purposes this morning, this particular altar in this particular city of Shechem really, for Abraham, is the altar of strength. Genesis chapter 12 is the reference if you want to turn there, beginning at verse number 6. It says that Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring, I'm going to give this land. I know many of us are familiar with this portion of Scripture, but wow, wait till you see how this gets unpacked this morning. I think Holy Spirit's going to really speak to you. So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. Now Abram to begin with, and then his name was changed to Abraham, and that's significant too. But I've only got 35 or 40 minutes this morning, and so every minute counts here this morning, right? Amen. Abraham was from a place called Ur, U-R. It's actually today modern Iraq. Now, this is something that we don't often think about when considering the father of the faithful. I mean, you know how they prayed in the Old Testament, right? The father, or the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, was a prayer that the Jewish nation prayed. It's something that they have carried on the tradition even to this day, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But do we really consider where Abraham or Abram came from? Joshua chapter 24, verse number 2, shines a little bit of light on something that you have to do a little digging, and this is where the historical background comes in, okay? So just kind of walk with me. I find this absolutely fascinating, and I know, if I were sitting with some of you ladies talking about Pinterest, I would probably get that glazed over look, and my head would begin to nod after a while, right? You know what I'm talking about, like some of you were attempted to do here this morning. But stay with me! This is so incredible. I love history. Abraham was raised in a family of idolaters. Remember, there was a pastor who's been preaching over the last few weeks about no more darkness. We've talked about the heavy soul, and I think one of them we talked about was the seducing soul, how the enemy likes to place idols, and anything can become an idol. And so it was for Abraham, Father Abraham, where he was raised in Ur amongst idolaters. Matter of fact, it's thought, when you look at history and a study of the artifacts for that time frame, that his family and those during that time, where he was raised, where he lived, would have been worshipers of the moon, and they would have worshipped the goddess Nana. At first, I thought it was Nana, and then I thought, whoa, my kids call, you know, my wife's mother Nana. Whew, I always knew she was a goddess, but didn't know she was the moon goddess. Nana? Any Nanas in the house today? It wasn't Nana, it was Nana, the moon god, goddess. Now in Genesis chapter 12, and this is very important, you want to write this down. And if you're in Genesis with your Bibles this morning, just stay there because that's kind of where we're going to be today. Genesis chapter 12, Yahweh, the God of creation, the God of man, the God of this world, speaks to Abram, this idolater, in a family of idolaters, and tells him, I want you to leave your family. I want you to leave everything that is familiar to you behind, and I want you to go to a land called Canaan. I want you to move forward. I want you to leave everything behind. I have something for you. So the Bible tells us in our opening text, so Abram, you don't have to turn there, Shar, but let me just bring it back to you. Abram went up from Egypt to Negev with his wife and everything that he had, and Lot went with him, and Abram had become very wealthy in livestock and in silver and in gold. And from the Negev, he went from that place until he came to Bethel and to the place between Bethel and Ai where his tent had been earlier. And it was there that he first built an altar. There Abraham called upon the name of the Lord. This is incredibly important. Shechem is a fairly important city in the Bible. We see this over and over. Shechem is actually located fairly in the middle, in case somebody goes home and checks up on this, you know, Google Maps, Old Testament, Google Maps. Shechem is fairly to the middle of Israel. And the thing about Shechem is that there was a route called the Ridge Route. And Shechem was a crossroad to major cities around Israel. So there probably weren't too many places that you would leave to go to another that you would not pass through Shechem. And so we see Shechem over and over and over in Scripture. It's very significant. Because of the traffic that Shechem saw is the reason why we see it mentioned so many times. Let me just give you a couple. I know I'm on a short leash this morning, but I have to give you some biblical illustration for us all to really understand and get a hold of this. Some of us would remember the story of Jacob. And we're going to talk about Jacob even a little bit more this morning. But Jacob is also someone in Genesis chapters 33 to 35. You would remember, those theologians in the house, that Jacob received a name change. Do you remember what Jacob's name was changed to? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob's name was changed to what? Israel. Do you know that it was near and within the proximity, within the boundaries, I should say, of Shechem in Genesis 33 to 35, that Jacob received his new name? What was he doing? You know what Jacob was doing? Jacob was literally tracing his grandfather's roots. I'm here to tell you, grandparents in the house today, if you have grandchildren who today are not serving the Lord, I tell you today, whose report will you believe? I will believe the report of the Lord. I believe that many of you grandparents who are praying for grandchildren who are not serving God today, I'm telling you, keep your eyes open and your ears open, because those kids are going to come to God. I believe that in the name of Jesus. There will come a time, there will be a crossroad. Hear me now. I think I might be speaking prophetically today. There will be a crossroad they will come to, and they're going to want to retrace the footsteps of their grandparents. I think some of you should. I see Anita. She's going like this. She's kind of waiting for everybody else to come on. Let's give the Lord some praise right now. They will retrace the footprints of their grandparents. We stand on that, don't we, Grandma and Grandpa? Yes, we do. And so Jacob traced Abraham's footsteps that took him to Shechem, where he had a wrestling match until he lost the match or won the match. I'm not sure which way. It depends. You look at the cup half full or half empty. But he got a new name. You'd also find it interesting to know that not too many years down the road, when Moses brought the Israelites out of Egypt, this would be another place that you would see the name Shechem, because it was one of the first places that they camped. And it was there that God said to Moses, he said, Moses, I want you to go to Shechem. Actually, it was on the borders of. I want you to go to Shechem, and I want you to pronounce the blessings and the cursings of the covenant. Now, because Moses was on the boundaries of Canaan, remember, Moses did not get to lead the people of God into Canaan, but who did? Joshua did. Therefore, in Joshua, the Bible tells us in actually Joshua chapter 8, that Joshua went to the place of Shechem. He kept the promise of Moses that Moses gave to God, that if I were to see the land of Canaan, this is what we will do. And Joshua got to fulfill that very promise. So over and over, we see some pretty incredible things relating to the city of Shechem, including the first place that Abraham built an altar unto the Lord, an altar of strength. Altar number 2. Genesis chapter 12, verse number 8. From there, he went on toward the hills east of Bethel, and he pitched his tent. This is from Shechem. With Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There, he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Genesis chapter 12, verse number 8 is the second altar that we find Abraham building. Now, Bethel is mentioned, 60 times in Scripture. This is pretty significant. But I want you to watch this. Because we understand, and again, those of us that are here today, we would know, we've heard preachers preach before, or we've been taught before, that the Hebrew name Bethel means house of God. This would be the altar of the presence of God. Now, how do we get there? How do we get there from here? One of my favorite Bible stories, aside from Samson, when I was being dropped off, Mom and Dad would drop me off at Grandma and Grandpa's house. Grandma would watch me in the summer while school was out. And I tell you, Grandma, she was just intentional that when she had little Darren Lee, I let my middle name out. When she had little Darren Lee, there was going to be prayer and there was going to be Bible study before Darren Lee went out to play. And I'm telling you, there'd be times, you've heard this before, maybe it's been a couple of years, my mom and dad would drop me off in the morning. There'd be times I'd sneak in. Man, Corey, I'd sneak in, and I would try to drop my bag off because the kids were already outside playing. And this is where, Grandma, she was the first of the Fantastic Four. I mean, her arm would come down from upstairs, down the stairs, around the banister, just her arm. I'm telling you, it was just her arm, right through the kitchen. I'd be heading out the door, she'd snatch me by the ear, and then together when she snapped, we would both meet right on Grandma's couch, and it was there that we would pray and have the Word of God before Darren could go out to play. Here's one of my favorite stories, aside from Samson. Genesis chapter 28, Jacob, remember Jacob, got the name Israel, left Beersheba, set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and he laid down to sleep. And he had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching into heaven. And the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Now, listen, I know today that angels are basically sexless and genderless. I did not know that when I was 6 years old. Neither did the people who published a little children's Bible that I used to read with Grandma. I loved looking at that story because the angels were so pretty. Man, those were pretty angels. I can remember reading that story with my grandma. Let's continue in the story. There above it stood the Lord. And he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. Ooh, are these familiar words? I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Woo! He said this to Grandpa. He's saying it to me too. On which you are, your descendants will be like the dust of the earth. You will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north, to the south. All peoples on the earth will be blessed through you and your offering and your offspring. I am with you, and you will watch over, and I will watch over you wherever you go. I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I promised in you, to you, for you. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place. And I was not aware of it. He was afraid, and he said, how awesome is this place, Peggy? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Early the next morning, Jacob took the stone in which he had under his head, and he set a pillar, and he poured oil on top of it, and he called the place Bethel. Though the city used to be called Luz, it would now be called the house of the Lord, which, you know what, represents the presence of God. Here's a fun fact. Remember, after Israel, the nation of Israel, came into and conquered the promised land, Bethel is one of their first places not only to camp. I think you'll find this interesting. It's one of the first places that the Ark of the Covenant made a home. And it was there at the place of Bethel that the Ark of the Covenant represented the presence of God to God's people. Are you thankful for the presence of the Lord? Come on, amen, amen. The third altar. Let's get going here. Somebody's slowing me down. I don't know who that is. The third one is Hebron. Come on, just make it through this historical stuff. How many's enjoying it so far? Yeah, okay, good. Good, just checking. Thank you for raising your hands. All the visitors appreciated seeing that. I know. Hebron. In the Hebrew, simply is translated to today's word, fellowship. Bible says in Genesis chapter 13, what is it? Verses 14 through 18. Let's read it. Here we go. The Lord said to Abraham, now, after Lot had parted from him, look around from where you are to the north and the south, to the east and the west. All this land, this is the land of Canaan, remember? Will I give to you and your offspring forever? We just read how God made the same promise to Jacob, his grandson. Oh, this is so incredible. Get a hold of this. I will make your offspring like the dust of the earth. Oh, my goodness. See, God is saying this first to Grandpa, and then he's going to say it to grandchildren, and then God is going to continue repeating this to more grandkids, and those grandkids are going to get a hold of it. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And he just says, go and walk through the length and breadth of the land, for I am giving it to you. So Abram went to live near the great trees of Mamre at Hebron, which Mamre actually means fat. How many like fat? I know what you're thinking. Thin is in. No, fat's where it's at. Mamre at Hebron, where he pitched his tents. And there he built an altar unto the Lord. Hebron is mentioned 87 times in Scripture. It's also a very significant city. Some of you would recall Joshua chapter 14. Caleb, that name ring a bell from the Old Testament, was given instructions to go and to conquer Hebron by Joshua. That was his assignment. And in Judges chapter 1, verses 1 through 20, we read that Caleb did exactly that and what a battle that was. Something else significant about Hebron is that King David, when David became king over Judah, he was anointed in Hebron. When King David became king over Israel, he was also anointed as king, to be king, 7.5 years later, also in Hebron. This is the altar of not just fellowship, but it's the altar of anointing. Somebody just go, do your best. Come on, do your best. It's the altar of anointing. Now, the significance of Hebron is really tied to the significance of Shechem and Bethel. Shechem, the altar of strength. Bethel, the altar of the presence of the Lord. and Hebron, the altar of fellowship or the altar of anointing. Now look at this conversation. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 3. Remember the idol worshiper, Abraham. Remember, we said God came to him in Genesis 12, verses 1 through 3, and the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing." Look at this. "I will bless those who bless you." I'm going to give you some good advice. I know when the Bible says in the Old Testament to touch not the anointed. Now, we misuse that. I'm just going to let you know that scripture was for a specific person at a specific time being spoken to a specific group of people. Sometimes we try to ride the coattails of promises in Scripture when they were made to certain people at certain times under certain circumstances. And that's theologically wrong to do. There are promises that are universal that you and I can jump onto, but the Scripture, "Touch not thine anointed," is, and I don't have really time to get into all of that, just research it, I think you'll find it interesting. But I don't think I would step too far. When the Bible talks to us in the book of James to New Testament believers about the speech that is coming out of our mouth. Hello? You've heard me talk before and say, listen, when you leave here this morning or when you leave this meeting, speak well of your church, speak well of one another, and speak well of your pastor. I'll tell you why. Even though I recognize that the Old Testament promise is made to certain people, certain time, certain situation, I'm going to tell you something. Man, if you speak against somebody who's walking with an anointing on the Lord, from the Lord, I'm here to tell you today that I believe that this scripture still applies to us today. I believe that you put yourself on shaky ground when you speak negativity, criticism, or harshly in any kind of arena, whether it's one-on-one with somebody else who's not the person you're talking about, or you speak it in a group setting and you create a negative atmosphere over somebody. I'm here to tell you, be cautious, because if they have the anointing of the Lord upon their life, you might be pulling curses your way. You can say amen or ouch. I'm not preaching for popularity today. And I'm not preaching to me, for me. I'm saying you look across the aisle, look at the people at the back of the heads who are in front of you, and people who are in front of you, just think about the people, faces of people who are behind you. This is the body of Christ. I'm here to tell you that I do believe in the principle that God spoke here in this portion of Scripture, where it is very important to us, for us to understand that those who speak blessing towards you and I will be blessed, and those who speak cursing towards you and I will be cursed. I believe in the Word of God. I tell you, be careful, little mouth, what you say. Oh, I can't hang there too long, Mike. They'll think it's personal this morning. It's not personal. It's Scripture. I want what God wants for you. God has a best for you, and I can't park there any longer. I got to move on right now. He says, "I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. Whoever curses you, I will curse, and all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you." Here's the neat thing, and I'm going to get to the second thing. Somebody shout the time out, because they've removed the clock. That's a dangerous thing to do. Whew, I've got another hour, don't I, Dale? Oh, thank you. I can't see those big 18-inch letters. Okay, time to get new glasses. Peggy, what are you laughing at? Man. So hear me. Here's the caboose for this part. Don't miss it. Abraham's journey, Ed, was intentional. It was incremental. Each step of Abraham's journey built upon the previous one. He went into Canaan. He found Shechem. He found Bethel. He found Hebron. And it was there that a bloodline of Yahweh, God chasers, altar builders, God worshipers were established and still live upon the face of this earth today, even when men like Hitler tried to erase them. They're still here today. Here's a second thing I'll tell you. The caboose will be when I say, and now here's the personal thing that God has been speaking to me for the last couple of weeks. But I got to give you number two first. Write this down. Very important for you to go home with this. Altars are a memorial of the places where God meets with his people. Woo! Doesn't that just send chills up and down your spine, Joe? I mean, it just gives you goosebumps on your goosebumps to think about this. Altars are a memorial of the places where God meets with his people. Look at the things now. I don't have time. Let me give you a short list. All of the Bible people that we just mentioned, all of the stories, all of the situations, and the hundreds of verses of Scripture that we just quickly breezed through this morning. Listen, at altars, there were life-changing transformations. Name changes, right? Jacob being one of them. People receive strength to bear the pain of harsh circumstances. Visions were seen, clear direction given. People overcame arduous problems. The presence of God was experienced. People fell on their faces and knew his name, felt his presence, heard his voice, saw his power. Needs were met, battles were won, and miracles were witnessed. Yeah, man, Frank, Pam. And this is what I've been thinking all week. At North Parkway Assembly of God, we need more of that. Oh, yeah. I love my church. I love you. I'm blessed to be called your pastor. I'm blessed to have you as friends and family. And I know this. When this journey began just a little bit over 2 years ago, God gave us some promises that our latter days would be greater than our former. I don't know. Some of you rewind and you go back, Keith and many of you, to days when, you know, this sanctuary was just flooded from wall to wall, and we didn't have these interior walls, which we're hoping to get down here very soon this year. But I mean, people were just from wall to wall in this place, and there were times you saw the altars flooded with people just coming in and wanting more of God. And you know something? I don't know, Rob, if we'll ever see those kind of numbers, because when we think of great, we oftentimes in the church world think of numbers. I'm more apt to think that rather than talking about quantity, that God is speaking about quality. Can you imagine seeing life transformations at a rate that we've never seen them ever before? And if the result are people from wall to wall in this building again, then so be it. But I'm more interested that we encounter the power and the presence of God, and then we leave the results up to him. Those types of things we need to see. And my conclusion is personal. I believe that the Lord wants us to revitalize the place of the altar in this church. Altars were a high point, Ryan, of the life of Abraham. The year was 1982. I was 14 years old. I had started going to a church because they had a gym and they played basketball on Friday nights. That was a lot of fun. A few months into me going and playing basketball, they had what they called a youth rally. How many of you remember the days of youth rallies? Yep, everybody over, there it is, 40, everybody over 40. Kids are thinking, what's a youth rally? Youth rally. It was at a youth rally in 1982 in Houlton, Maine. Somebody gave what we call an altar call. That means, hey, anybody here want to make some things right with God, you want to become a Christian, you want to really sell your life out to Him, we want to pray with you. There's people down here to pray. I remember being one of those 14-year-old kids at that youth rally that went down to the altar, found somebody to pray with me. And I, even though I had been exposed to God through praying grandparents and a grandma, you know, with that fantastic forearm, you know, even though it was at 14 years old, Fran, that I made what I would call a significant, lasting, begging cry to God to save me. I've not been a perfect man, my wife says amen, since that age. I met her just 4 years later. She's not perfect either, don't look at me like that. 14 years old, I asked Him into my life. 1 year later, 1983, I went to youth camp, not because of basketball, but because of a girl, a 16-year-old girl that I really liked from our youth group, and I was afraid she would get a boyfriend that summer from camp, and so I had to go to camp just to make sure. But God has a way of using things like that. Huh? Who said that's right? Was that you, Corey? Yeah, no? Blame it on the right person, right? And it was there, after 1 year of going to youth group, that I came down to the altar, and it was there that I experienced what we know today, and I know today, as the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I, for the first time, spoke in a language that was not taught by man, but came from God in that altar as I worshiped Him. The next year, where are we now? 1984. I was 16 years of age. And in 1984, I went back to that same summer camp after being saved 2 years earlier, filled with the gift of the speaking in tongues the next year. And that year, I stood in the altar, and while this red-headed evangelist by the name of Tiff Shuttlesworth, who was in his early 20s at the time, was singing and playing his guitar, "What a mighty God we serve." I got some of y'all on that one. Yeah, they say, sing it. Come on, sing it. Kids are thinking, what kind of rhythm is that? That's hokey. That's, "What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before Him. Heaven and earth adore Him. What a mighty God we serve." You know, tambourines, hallelujah. Those were the days. I can play a mean tambourine. This one, Sunday I'm going to whip it out. I'm telling you, I'm going to tambourine you to death. Just, you're going to get it. I'm closing. And it was there that God said to me, "You're going to follow in the footsteps of some of your family members, and you are going to preach my gospel." And I sold out in my life that night at that campground to the ministry. Didn't know what that was going to look like. Had no idea. All of those experiences, Danny, happened in an altar. Now, I want to say this to you this morning, because I'm talking to folks here today who I know you understand that we can make a personal altar in our heart anywhere. There are folks who are about to do this at home, watching us via live stream here this morning. They're going to make an altar right at their home. There are many of us who make an altar while we're driving down the road. Some of you, your devotion time may be with God on your way to work. If you've got much of a drive, 15, 20, 30 minutes, the worship music goes on. Maybe you read your word before you started driving, and then you just go into your worship time, and there becomes your personal altar. But I'm talking about a physical altar. I don't know about you, but when somebody mentions the word altar, for me, I think of something tangible. I think of something visible. I think of something that I have stood in on many occasions of my life since the age of 16 years old in Bible college, trying to allow God to work sanctification in my life, trying to find that place of anointing upon my life to be the type of pastor and preacher that God wants me to be, praying with so many others, broken homes, broken situations, broken people, over the course of almost 30 years that my wife and I have been praying with people in the physical place of the church that we call the altar. And you know what? I'm talking to people here today who you've seen some of the very same things that I have. If you've been in the Lord, in the way of the Lord for any amount of time, you've seen life-changing transformations. Woo! I've seen people who have one name, I've seen them get a new name. Oh man, I can't help myself now, Teddy. And I don't mean they got a name change, you know, go down to the courthouse and change it. I mean they got a new name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Your name once was this, but you got a new name written in the Lamb's Book of Life when Jesus came into your heart. I've seen that happen. I've seen people receive strength to bear the pain of harsh circumstances. I've seen people have visions and get clear direction for arduous problems. I've seen people experience the presence of God, hear the voice of God, feel the power of God, hallelujah, and walk out of that altar a transformed man and a transformed woman. They might have been a man or a woman with problems or situations still ahead of them, but God gave them the strength to face anything and everything, because greater is he who's in them than he that is in this world. I've seen that happen in physical altars all of my life. Now this is where it gets real personal. As the guys in the back room get ready, in just a moment, not yet, they're going to play a song that we've been listening to for the last few, 3 or 4 weeks, that takes us into our, what we call our altar time. Oh, Come to the Altar by Elevation Worship. They're going to play it in just a moment. But before they do, here it is. Because alterations take place in the altar. A-L-T-E-R. What's the rest of that? A-T-I-O-N-S. Because alterations, don't laugh. You laugh with me, thank you. Take place in the altar. I come to you today as your pastor, and I challenge all of us here today to consider what place the altar has in our life. I'm not talking about the altar you make at home. I'm not talking about the altar that you make all by yourself in your sitting room. I know Dave and Lori have, they have a prayer room. It's designated. It's where they read. It's where they pray. Some of you have places in your home. I'm talking about this altar that when you and I come together as the family of God. And I really feel badly because, listen, there's a whole generation that potentially will have no idea of what I'm talking about right now, because many churches, even in our movement, the Assemblies of God, have stopped having altar services. They are giving altar calls, which is fine. God can work right where you're sitting in your seat. But can I just tell you something, without making any apologies? As for me and my house and the church that I pastor and where I believe and what I believe God wants to do in our lives, as far as I feel, we will always have a place called the altar, and we will always know what an altar call is. Amen. We'll always know what an altar call is. It's significant. It's important. It's just as important as the place of Hebron. It's just as important as the place of Bethel. It's just as important as the place of Shechem. Stones with dirt and mud, and then oil poured upon them. And in some cases, old dirty, I shouldn't say dirty, but lambs. They were spotless, without blemish. But you know what I'm talking about. Dirty animals that were laid on those altars and sacrifices made. We don't do that any longer. We don't have to deal with the natural blood, because Jesus is the Lamb that was slain from the foundations of this world. But I believe when we come to the altar, there's opportunity for transformation. Would you stand with me today? God bless you. I love you so much. God loves you so much. Bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment. Not because we're embarrassed, but just out of reverence, okay? I want to encourage all of us here today to consider the role that the altar has in our lives. Though we make personal altars at home, I'd like for us to consider the altar of our church. What role does it have in your life? Are you taking, hear me, just here's some questions I jot. Are you taking advantage of opportunities to experience altering, transformation, His presence, His power, miracles, clear direction? I know God can speak to us anywhere, anytime, any place. But here's my question. Is it possible that we could be missing something when we do not take opportunities to go to the family altar in the house of God to hear, to experience, and to feel what maybe the Lord wants to do in our life? I think it's very possible, and I'll tell you why. I think, Donna, it's because the Lord has been speaking to me very strongly over the past 2 weeks. Brad, the last 2 weeks, very strongly, saying, Darren, we need to do a better job at the altar of our church. Okay. I hear what you're saying, preacher, but what are you asking me to do? I'm asking you to consider revitalizing the place of the altar in your life. I know, and it's just the type of pastor that I am, many, many times I give an altar call that's very specific. It's very, very specific. And I know what it feels like on the other side of the pulpit. That man, you know, pastor was just talking about this. And even though we know anybody can go down to the altar area to be prayed for by one of the wonderful designated people that we have to pray for folks on a Sunday, they're going to think I have that specific problem. That's not the problem that I have. So I'm just, I don't know. Maybe we need to get over that. But you know what? Maybe as a pastor who God is speaking to about the altar, maybe I can do a better job of taking that pressure off. You know, maybe I can say something like, you know, right, folks who come down here might not be coming down here, you know, because they've got this particular secret sin in their life, but maybe they just want to get closer to God. I don't know. I'm going to really talk to God about how I can frame those words. But in my heart of hearts, I know this is what we need to see. I'm not asking for it this morning. You know, come on. I know some of you husbands are thinking, oh, man, the music's going to go up. My wife's going to reach over. She's going to say, honey, we need to go to the altar because of what the preacher said. We don't want him to feel bad. We need to go to the altar. It's not about that. I'm not here today to pull teeth. I'm not here to make anybody feel guilty. I'm here today to give you a message from the Lord, a question. Do I need to revitalize the place of the altar in my life? And you know my answer is yes, for me. So I think this is what we're going to do today. There are folks here who maybe you're feeling something in your body, you're dealing with something, maybe there's sickness. And you're going to come for prayer. We're going to have people here to pray for you. There's other folks, you're going through some real traumatic experiences. You need someone to pray for you. There's other folks here today who you could feel the Holy Spirit just tapping you on the shoulder, saying, listen, 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 because I want you to revitalize the place of the altar in your life. So if you have to, you know, push your, on a weekly basis, if you have to push your restaurant reservations off to 12:15 or 12:30, then that's what you need to do. If you need to let the family know, hey, lunchtime's going to be, you know, 12:30 rather than, you know, 12:15, because I don't know if you have to give an excuse, but whatever the case may be, maybe we just need to be planning some time in our morning for the altar. So if you're here this morning, in just a moment, and I know there's folks, maybe you need to slip out. I know there's other folks, you have some family commitments, you have some things happening. I know I know Dave and Glenda need to slip out as quickly as possible, and anyone else who needs to, please. I don't want you to feel this is not a teeth-pulling session. This is simply to say, is Holy Spirit speaking to you about revitalizing the place of the altar and what he can do in you and through you because of it? Then as the song comes up, I'm going to ask our prayer team, if you would quickly come forward. Prayer team, if you would just be right here in front of the communion table, the altar team here, and we're going to leave the wings, the altar wings, the side, the left and the right. We're going to leave this space open to the left and to the right if anybody wants to come and just spend a few more moments, okay? But now here, look on up at me before you go. Before you go, I want to say this. God's got great things for you. I want to just get as many eyeballs as I can. God's got great things for you. And this message is for you today. And it's very possible that there might be some things that God wants to do through the place called the altar. Strength, presence, power, and anointing. And Lord, that we receive today in Jesus' name. As the music comes up, if you want to come down and find a place to pray or stand and worship, you can do that. If you want special prayer, we have a team of people here to pray with you. But can we put this message to practice today? Come on.
Are you hurting, broken, thin?
Respond to the altar today.